Welcome back to the Masters of Endurance 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing. We are currently looking at the lead car. NX Racing Red continues to be in the lead. Dave Gallick behind the wheel, 1 minute 37 ahead of Commander Simsports, Klaus Kivikas. That gap is coming down.
Yeah, indeed. That Commander Simsport car is putting in some pretty decent laps at the moment. It's best time across the entire 21 hours that we've done so far has been an 18.4, and their last lap time was an 18.7. So they're not running very far off of that in comparison to the NX Racing Red car, which has done 20.2 on the previous lap. So they are they're definitely pulling in that gap. Whether it's going to be fast enough. Or enough, you know, you've got to think that NX Racing Red have got quite a comfortable gap at the moment. You know, whether it's going to be enough for Commander Simsport, we don't know. But they're definitely pushing for the win at the moment.
Yeah, indeed. It looks like this race is definitely not over yet. It's a tough one for sure, but with the amount of time we have, it's a cliche to say it, but anything can happen. Just looking at some tweets on Twitter, obviously, where else? Hashtag IRMOE, Pablo Lopez, 22 minutes ago, for America, just said, I finished all my stints, what a race. After two stop and goes and two drive-throughs, we're running in the top five. We've got a shot for fourth, but not likely. So yeah, he's now going to sort of enjoy watching the rest of this, I reckon.
Indeed. As on screen we have Core Motorsports, who were in third place, have just come out of the pit lane. I believe they're just on. They've dropped back behind the NX Racing blue car, and I believe they've also dropped back behind a Berica Racing team. The live time is just not updated for me.
They're not behind them just yet. They're only 4 seconds behind the NX Racing blue car, 10 seconds ahead of Iberica Racing.
Okay.
Blue car will pit soon, yes. After a 25 lap stint.
Yeah, so we're just coming. I'm assuming we're at the end of or in a pit stop phase for a lot of these teams based on the time. Not the last one, but approaching that zone very quickly, where there's probably only a couple more pit stops to go. And when they're done, I don't know how much of a race we're going to have on for the lead. It doesn't look like so much at the moment. Of course, there's a lot of traffic and stuff like that to navigate, which is going to fluctuate that gap quite a bit. But NX Racing Red have got a lot of time to play with at the moment, so it's looking comfortable for them. But 1 minute 36. Seconds and 3 hours, you never know what could happen.
Yeah, that's 30 seconds an hour. That's a tall order.
Yeah, that is quite the tall order, but you never know. You never know.
Scott Michaels actually. I might be wrong here. He looks like he's closed down the gap to Team TTL. Now 1 second back.
Oh yeah, the McLaren on screen is the McLaren in the foreground rather than background now. The car that he is chasing down. So that is for position, and that will be a fight if they can close up. It'll be the only fight within the top 15 at the moment. So, or probably across the entire grid, really. But they are definitely. Getting very close to the back of that McLaren.
The next racing blue car is now making their pit stop. Actually, they're driving through the pit lane. In order to get 60 cars here, we need the endurance pits, which includes the GP and the Classic. We get 60 cars out of it, however, pit stop now takes about 90 seconds to perform, so that's, you know, driving through pit lane and whatnot. I think it's actually more than that. I think it's more like 105 5 seconds from what I've seen with some of these gaps.
Yeah, it's one mighty long pit lane. At Spa, with as you said, both the pit lanes, there's a tight turn at the top of it, and what would be the end of the source, and down the hill, it's a very, very long pit lane. We are getting very close to this position change, as they're going to have a look on the inside through block. It's just lifted,
and they both run a little wide there.
Wow.
Just more like evasive action more than anything.
Yeah. But either way, there is the position change, which is probably not something we're going to see too much at this stage of the race. But the R4R Motorsports car has got them in front of the Team TTL, as a few other cars are in the pit lane.
Yeah. By the looks of it, R4R have made their third to last pit stop, and Team TTL still need to make it. They're going to be making it in the last or in the next two laps or so.
Yeah. So that R4R car being in 12th position, I believe. It's probably not going to be 11th because I think they've got too much of a gap to the car in front. But for them to have been in 12th position, that's a very good run for them at the moment, especially considering Scott Michaels has pulled off that move whilst being behind the wheel for a very, very long time when it's lose concentration. But a great drive nonetheless.
See Birka Racing. They 20 laps into their run, and Core Motorsports are only two. So Birka still need to make. This is actually if they can. I don't think they can, but I'm pretty sure they need to do three more pit stops as well. It's going to be a splash at the end.
Yeah, I think they're running. They're trying, although they were earlier at least, clearly, based on where they are with the strategy, because they're very off-kilter to everyone else. It looks like they were trying to push the car and do one less stop than the other guys, and yeah, if it works, that's great, but when you think, they've got about five or six more laps of this stint, maybe a couple more longer than that, which is the next 15 minutes, it's just pushing it a little bit too far, I think. I think they would be struggling for fuel to the end of the final stint, and would run out probably 10-20 minutes too early.
Yeah,
but they might try it.
Yeah, they got to go. Let's see. Actually, the math here. I don't want to guess too much. So they can go almost 16 minutes. So then that would have been from where we started checking. That would have been 2 hours, 26 minutes remaining. So they need to do 2 hour, 13 minute stints. I don't see that as possible. I may be wrong, but I don't see that as possible.
I don't really know. That is. I mean, earlier on in the race, I think it might be on the edge of plausibility, but they would have to do some magic fuel saving for those two stints to make that work.
I think that's way too much. I think that's probably four laps longer than what they can do.
Either way, we'll have to keep an eye on that car and see what they actually do attempt, trying to get that top four position.
Short pit actually might still give them the fourth position.
That is absolutely true, yeah, because they won't be in pit lane for very long at all if they're going for a short splash. So they could actually be looking very good for this fourth place. And if they just went in for a splash, that would be just a little bit of security. But yes, that's a car we're definitely going to have to keep our eye on towards the end of this race in the battle with the next racing blue car.
I think they can do it. The lead, at least. Whoa! Not if they're getting off tracks like
that. Yeah, that was a fairly wide run.
Yeah, they've already been penalized twice for off tracks. possible they could get a third time, and they don't want it this late in the race.
No, mistakes like that which will cost you something like fourth place. So yeah, you want to keep those errors to an minimum. But they are unfortunately very easy to make at this track, especially because there's a few turns with quite a lot of runoff. Bonchamont's a good example of that. Even though Rouge on the outside, there's a few turns where there's just a comfortable amount of runoff. Not like too much where, you know, you can just drive off wherever you want, but there's just a comfortable amount. Unfortunately, there's a comfortable amount and then a wall, so.
Yeah, we're letting people, you know, avoid, you know, whatever problems they may have by using the runoff. It's just the fact that, you know, we've seen, actually from this car in general, we've seen where they're using a runoff as, you know, a little bit of an advantage. And because of that, we've had to penalize them twice, so. Just have to watch, make sure they don't do it again.
I agree that the runoff's there is quite a good area to avoid incident, which can happen quite a lot. So yeah, having that area to run off to go to is good, but then you do get the odd people that just sort of throw themselves over it as a way of finding more time, and that's not on.
This is another battle here that we may have a battle at the end of the race with this. Currently,
but they're on exactly the same strategy. They're both 9-lap stint.
Yeah, this is all pace right here, basically. I don't know if Virgil will want to push too hard, because then, you know, they risk possibly, you know, crashing. So they may take it easy here. And yeah, it's funny, the car directly behind them is actually the car that's at one position ahead of them.
Possibly going a lap down then fairly shortly. But it's an interesting thing with this car. It qualified in the top 10 and then sort of, I think it was outside the top 20 when I left. So it's been quite up and down the order all over, and it's interesting to see it up in that sixth place in the fight to defend it with Virgil Racing. But that car has been up and down the order quite a bit throughout the day, and it's nice to see that if you've dropped outside of that position, obviously there's a lot of time that you can use to get yourself back into a good position, which they currently are in.
Yeah, we actually, you guys were asleep, but in the middle of the night, there's an incident where one of the cars ran out of fuel. And, well, he's about to run out of fuel, and he's coasting to the pits. And they were just right in the middle of the track, to be honest. And Mohamed Espatel was driving for Team Camaro 2, tried to go to the inside, but drove all the way onto the grass, and contact was made. Thankfully, the Camaro car, as you can see, didn't really get any damage from it. But they're pretty lucky to avoid, big incidents. They had that small one there. I think they've had little other spins or little bits of contact, but nothing too bad.
Yeah, they've run. Yeah, other than that, it's been consistent, like you say.
I'm not proud of myself for drinking that whole cup of coffee, but it has woke me up a little bit.
I'm pretty tempted to do the same. although I've not been up all night, but, you know, sitting in a chair and talking is really difficult.
It's a hard life.
So that's the NWSS Scarlet car that is just being passed by the Chimera car. A bit of damage on that.
Yeah, they had an incident earlier. I guess they can actually track straight now. They had, they got spun and then hit in the door. When that happened, it looked like their car was not crabbing per se, but like some form of suspension was hurt on it. Seems to be fixed now. As we last lap, 0.4 in Virgil Racing's direction. So who knows? This might shrink, and we may have a battle on our hands toward the end. We actually have a battle, possibly, further back between the 97 and the 119. That's KRT Motorsport 2 and CTC Racing 2.
Yep, that's Carl Murdig in the KRT car, the McLaren, the white McLaren, in 26th. And Andrea Ventura in the CTC Racing BMW, just a second or so behind, in 27th. Strategy-wise, KRT is 16 laps into their stint, CTC 21 seconds into their stint. Laps, even, yep.
21 seconds, they got some fresh tires.
Yeah. So still be in the pit lane.
Yeah, I would be amazed they've gotten around the track on 21 seconds of tires.
Actually, what I was going to do to begin with was make that stint thing a time-based. However, I don't know, I decided to go with laps instead. I thought laps would be a better representative of it.
Yeah, it's probably for the best. It just makes a bit more sense, but easier to read.
Well, stints are, time's interesting as well, because, you know, it's a timed race, so you want to see how long, but it's either way.
Okay, either way, these two are very close for position for the two of the cars, and I would assume a change for it might appear towards Les Combes at the end of the Kemmel Strait, so keep an eye on that BMW.
You're actually going to be looking back from the 97 car right now, just to kind of give us a little bit different view. We've been in TV cam for a while, haven't done any onboards.
That BMW racing up to the back, pulls over to your right, that's the outside for Les Combes. Has actually got the full overlap and is passed. Just needs to brake properly, but hasn't. And that allows KRT to have another go, but KRT jinks out of the way and is now down to 27th position. Could have been an opportunity for KRT to get back in front. And now Index Racing Blue is right behind. Just trying to get past both of them and get a little bit held up.
I had many visions of Formula One right there. And Lewis Hamilton and Nico Rosberg coming together at the at that corner in similar fashion. So good job that they didn't do the same thing, because that could have cost them quite a bit within the race.
I have another one going on here. Here we go. Now we're getting into some battles. Oh no, this battle's been going on for hours. For anyone who's following, like 4 hours ago, we followed this battle for no joke, like 7 laps. And it was nose to tail and nothing happened. Very similar. I think a couple of you were here for the Radicals Online and Glacier Racing.
Yeah.
But yeah, All-Star Racing, number one, or their number, team number one. It's a three car versus Trinity Motorsports. They're number one.
Oh, whoa, stop. All-Star. Oh, flips over. That's a huge crash. Yes. And in the middle of the road, still flipping down the road.
Yes.
On their wheels. Goodness gracious me, that was unfortunate.
Be careful here. Hopefully they do kind of like what Phoenix did and drive forward to that gap.
Yeah, it looks like they're what they're doing. Oh, no, they're not.
Oh, they should be okay.
Yeah, I think they're okay.
Don't go all the way back.
Yeah, but if they'd have taken out Grand then.
Should we see if we can get a replay of that one?
No, I had it live on stream. You can see it pretty
much. Oh, yeah, of course,
there.
Yeah. So I'm just under pressure. Shit. Was about to be
That is broken.
Yeah, that car is really not handling well.
I couldn't tell if he... Oh, yeah, he's about to do a tow. I think he's going to stop here. That was probably the smartest thing to do. Going to lose a ton of time either way, so might as well just take the tow. Possibly even faster sometimes to do that.
Yeah, that's a shame. That's a shame, but that was a pretty heavy hit into the wall, and a lot of damage to the All-Star Racing team.
They had been, where were they at that, before they had the accident? They were up in
24th?
Yeah, probably. I can probably wind back and find out.
23rd, I think, actually, looking at where Trinity Motorsports are.
Yes, yeah. 23rd position. It was a battle for 23rd when that happened. Look at the gap here between the top two cars, and it looks like, well, you can look at their last lap times. Almost identical.
Yeah, it doesn't look like it's going to be coming down too much anytime soon. But I'm sure Quanda will actually give them a good run for their money, especially later on in the race, but looks like at the moment it might be a bit easier said than done for Quanda Simsport.
It's been a great race by both teams. Not like it's over. I mean, not even 22 hours done yet.
No, indeed, it's been a long day for some of these guys. I mean, these 24-hour races are not easy. They are very, very difficult. They're very stressful. Even if you don't think of it as a sleep thing, you know, it depends on how tired people are. It's not just about. It's the pressure of being in a car where a group of people at this point have put in 22 or 21 and a half hours worth of work in this race alone. Then you've got all the setup work that's gone into it, all of the laps that people have put in. You know, you are talking hours and hours of work to have put this car in this position. It's very, very easy to have fallen into under pressure, basically. Also, the Iberica race did enter pit lane.
Yes, they have just exited, actually. They're 20 seconds, it looks like, exactly behind NX Racing Blue here. So, now, my math isn't going to be the greatest. I believe fuel to refuel a car is 40 seconds? I may be incorrect on that. I want to say that I'm correct, though. I want to say it's roughly 40 seconds, 35 to 45 seconds. So if you cut that, let's say, in half, I don't know how much fuel they're going to need for their final stint, but it's going to be a really low amount. So if you cut that up, I think they're going to be able to jump an X Racing Blue, unless they can build a gap here much larger than 20 seconds. I think closer to 30 is what they're going to need.
Even then, you know, it's 15 seconds every hour, basically, although there is an hour and a half, or a couple of 2 hours and a half, rather. But, you know, they've got that time to build that gap or to negate it, either way. So, that definitely is not over, that duel. Absolutely not. That's going to be one that we are going to have to look at and keep an eye on, because that's not going to be over.
Yeah, and another thing is, and they had Jack in the car, and I would say put the quicker driver in, but Jack's actually done pretty quick laps. He's a good amount into the stint. 7 laps currently into the stint. 19.8. Oh, not too bad. Especially since that would be seen as our second car right now. That's pretty good. So maybe they'll have the, I don't know who the fastest driver is for an X Racing Blue. However, they'll probably end up putting him in for the final 2 hours. We'll see.
Yeah, Jack's he's a pretty quick driver. I've only driven with him in one series, and you know, he's quick even without practice. He's a quick driver, so yeah, clearly showing that he's definitely got the pace to run with the top lot here.
Yeah, he doesn't even like the BMW whatsoever, but you know, NX Racing Blue asked if he could help simply because, well, they really wanted a fifth driver. They weren't sure about Timu even, and he's been you know, either out of town or sick or dealing with Oval DWC, he hasn't really been able to practice that much. So currently he's been able to practice the past 2 days, I guess you could say 3 days maybe. and then also Jack last minute call up as well. So they've actually salvaged, even if they get fifth place, a top five is pretty much a win for them.
Yeah, and a good result either way, you know, on this grid, which we all know is extremely quick grid that we've got at Masters of Endurance, and running over this length of time, you know, any result that you can pull from this is actually just a really good one either way. So let alone top five being an utterly fantastic result.
See Virgil Racing, a little damage to the front of their car. Probably a little loss of front downforce. Who knows, that may be good. That means they're not killing their rear tires as much, just creating a little bit of understeer by lack of front downforce. They're trying to chase down Team Kimura. Got it down to 7. Last time we checked, it was 10. So this looks promising for them, to be honest. Kimi's really good at Spa.
So, Kimi is only good at Spa.
Only good?
There goes the Kimi hate.
Yes. Now, what's up with that? I mean, he looked pretty good at Hungary the past few years, besides, you know, this past year.
You don't want to ask Oscar as to his opinion of Kimi Raikkonen. It's... Oh, wow.
I was thinking of just replacing him with anyone that finished in the back half of the GP2 field last year, because it would be a better decision.
Oh my goodness. There's some hate going on right now. I'm just going to look at the top
of TeamSpeak. Phil's just going to look the other way because he likes Kimi Raikkonen.
No, I'm going to look at the top of TeamSpeak and I'm ready for all the Finnish people to join and jump right into the commentary box waiting room. And we're not going to be able to allow any of them in the channel simply because they're just going to race.
Yeah, no one give them my address or anything.
Oh, goodness. And we still see 6/10 of a second there, Virgil Racing gaining on Team Kimura. Another one that could come down here. I think it might even be done by the next hour. End of the next hour. With 1 hour remaining, we may see the battle. At this rate, at least.
Yeah, at this rate, indeed. I'm sure we're going to see that map before the end of the race. And yeah, I don't see there's a way around that. It's going to happen at some point, and possibly within the next hour and a bit, it's going to be starting. But that Virgil Racing car is going pretty quick at the moment.
Yeah, maybe they'll have been testing, or even Mohamed Espetel's been really fast. I don't know who the fastest driver is.
Probably say Ben Testing from just who I know with that list.
Yeah, Ben Testing's been pretty quick so far this season. Wasn't as quick at Suzuka as he was at, for example, Road America, but you know, that Team Kimura team's really shined this season. Been very consistent and whatnot.
Yeah, so it's a good team amongst them. Clearly, you know, they're getting it. They're in sixth at the moment, which is a good result. They all have a little bit of a fight for it. They're running in a good position at the moment.
Just want to note that Honic Racing number 84 car just lost connection to the server, and now Nestoros has just jumped in. Gonna flip to them really quickly to see. Now going to have a tow. Just a note, and Road America, they had a similar situation about a third of the way through a lap, and when they lost connection, their second driver jumped in instantly. And what happened was they didn't get a tow, number one, and then number two, their pit stall was before the start finish line, So then when they passed their start-finish line, it counted them as the next lap. So they gained a lap on the entire field. And we had to go back and subtract the time that they had gained through that. Not sure if anybody stayed with me on that one.
Yeah.
Vaguely.
I honestly, my brain at the moment, I did not sleep very well amongst my sleepy period, so I'm still quite tired, although not as tired as people have been awake all the time.
Did you not sleep well because I was crushing you at Fibbage?
No, it was not because of that. It was because of... it might have been because of that. Oh, all right. I'll give it to you. You're a horrible person.
You're rubbish at that game, by the way.
Playing Fibbage?
Yeah, we've been playing Fibbage.
That is a fun game. A fun looking game. I've not played it, but I've watched it being played.
In all fairness, I keep winning because I know the answers, which is sort of against the point.
There's some good ones in there.
What was it? The kitchen sink. What did the owner of Blockbuster send to Netflix in the post?
Yes, I did not know of this one. I cannot remember which one I clicked.
I think I might have heard it on... never mind, Buzzcocks, you know. It might have been a question on there. Or something like that. Maybe QI.
Holy
yeah.
Cow. Virgil Racing. Gaining quite a bit each lap. Actually lost that lap, though.
What was it? Two laps before. It was about 0.7 they were finding?
Yes. So now they're dropping back. And also, want to note that America Racing Team... They have went from 22 seconds when they first came out of the pits down to 20 seconds to NX Racing Blue. Obviously, they have a little bit fresher tires since they came here, so they're going to gain some time here.
Yeah, possibly a bit more luck with the traffic as well, as to, you know, when you're finding it. And yeah, bits and bobs like that. But as I say, this is one that we're going to have to keep an eye on, strategy-wise. I don't know. I don't think it's going to be a legitimate overtake on track. But what I mean by that is I don't think they're going to close down that 20-second gap and then pass NX Racing Blue. I think it's going to be through the strategy that this car is going to get ahead. And it's looking good at the moment, especially if they're running that kind of race. If they can pull this kind of strategy game on them, they are looking good for that fourth place at the moment as the Iberica Racing Team, although we don't want to give them the commentator's curse.
And because of that, we won't even look at them. Let's see here. We have, last time I checked, Scott Michaels was not that far from Joel Guez. However,
it's about 10 seconds between him.
10 seconds back now. Stadler still in the pits for All-Star Racing Team. Number three car we saw had a huge incident.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it was him or someone else who was actually at the wheel of the car when they crashed.
He's currently sitting in the car ready to go, but I don't think that his car is going to be fixed anytime soon.
Just had a spin at the chicane for Macau Racing, who spun at the exit of the bus stop. Ben Matziards in position 32.
Ooh, okay, the first one then.
Yeah, yes, Mad Cow Racing number one, car 22.
The one that actually does look a Mad Cow.
Yeah, that car is looking haggard.
It's been like that actually for most of the race.
But it's one broken car.
Oh, it's weird, we actually interviewed one of the drivers and they said that the car actually feels better. That it actually might be even faster than it was previously with that damage.
Yeah, it's quite often the case with these longer races, you sort of get used to.
That's what I think it is as well.
Next time I'll do a GT3 race, I'll throw it in a wall and see where I go. In iRacing, I'll make sure to give that one a go.
Yeah, you just do doing like a turn of front wing before a pit stop. You give it a turn of smashing into a wall.
I don't know if you guys know this, because I know you guys don't follow iRacing all that much, and definitely don't follow the oval side of iRacing. Quite a few years ago, I don't know if you know who Sandeep is by any chance? He raced in Oval DWC. I believe it was Oval DWC. I don't know if it was Oval Pro or not. And he got damaged while racing at Darlington. And somehow he ended up going faster. The car just hooked up better in the corners. And he was able to go faster and ended up winning the race.
Wow.
We hear stories of people who get damage in races on iRacing who then will go and crash the other side into a wall to try and balance it out.
Nice.
It never works.
It doesn't ever work. I've tried lots of times.
They're crabbing and they try to hit the wall to try to straighten it out. It ain't going to work.
All that ever happens is I get a Star Master that looks like a drag racing car.
That's because on the Star Masters it's not really supposed to... No. It's not supposed to work. No.
We were in a practice session and I had some damage. And by damage, I mean I might have accidentally spun through the grass on the front straightaway, ended up in my pit stall, and I might have had heavy damage to the rear suspension. And when the car went to start getting repaired, it completely just bounced my car up and out of the pit stall.
Oh wow. Yeah, see, I've got a few pictures of what it's like to practice with Oscar and the damage you get in some skip barbers. Wow. I also have a video of what happens if you break the suspension properly on a DW12. They break dance.
I got some penalties pointed in my name for what happens when Oscar blocks you a lot.
Oh, so. I remember this.
I want to hear the story.
Was this, I forget the name of the series.
It was NDR's, TBO series.
Yes.
TBO series is basically road cars with turbos. There's a front-wheel drive, a rear-wheel drive, and an all-wheel drive. Pretty fun
And real
class.
Men drive the rear-wheel drive.
Yeah, exactly. And it's pretty much a touring car series type thing. Live for speed. And let's just say that
on a scale of how aggressive was my blocking through turn one at KY2R?
So basically, KY2R, just think of it as Daytona road course.
Yes, Daytona road course, isn't it, basically?
And think about the fact, you know, you have a run on somebody, and every time you go to stick your nose under the person on the Daytona oval, down on you, and they don't spin. Instead, they're knocking you sideways and whatnot, and you're getting screwed over by it, and, you know, you get angry. The first corner, I'm right behind Oscar, and I hit the brakes, and I'm right on Oscar's bumper, and then I let off the didn't hit the gas, just let off the brakes a little, and we might have had contact, and we might have both ended up in the wall. I took
Genius.
Blame for that,
right
obviously.
There. Genius.
Yeah. So that's one of the only penalties in my name, but it's a pretty big one.
I think I hold that one quite dear to me, the ability to induce that much rage in Phil Diaz.
Yeah,
well, you just induced that much rage in a lot of people.
In humans.
Yeah.
I'm pretty
yeah.
sure that everyone's heard me this entire 22 hours now, and they've heard that I'm a pretty calm person. So, yeah, for you to get rage
you
out of me.
You weren't after that one, mate.
Yeah, that's...
You weren't, yeah, you weren't, you weren't. I think, like, maybe in your younger days, you were less calm. I think you've mellowed over the years.
Yeah, I think it's more of a thing of not caring as much. By that, I don't mean as, like, not caring about MOE or something like that. It's just, you know,
it's not the end of the world.
And, yeah, exactly. Things happen, and it's not the end of the world. Just move on from it. If people had money and stuff invested into this, then yes, you know, that's a big deal. But, you know, entry fee... doesn't exist, and you know this is just here for fun, and honestly really nothing more. It's just here for fun. I think most teams have showed that, and they get in a competitive level, but that competitive level is fun for them.
I think it's sort of, it's a nice environment to be in where the worst that can happen to you is that you leave with what you started with. Like, you do not lose anything by entering this series and doing badly, and that's got to be, you know, that's a very good way to come into it, and it sets up people having a better mentality about the racing.
Just having a look at our hashtag IRMOE on Twitter, had a few tweets in the last hour. Blue Flag Racing, the supporter of this event, mentioned about Scott Michaels and his 300 laps he's done so far. Hashtag Iron Man. You reckon he's going to have Simrace the flu for a week? But yeah, I think probably achy arms at the very least. Corner Motorsports tweeting, only 2.5 hours left, we're still running in third, keep your fingers crossed. Phoenix Motorsports saying they've got some damage, but we're still racing. P13 with a bit more than 2 hours to go, 25 seconds behind P12. And Radicals Online, they're happy to see the mighty Paul Ilbrink in the Radicals roof pushing in 8th position. Go Rads, hashtag IRMOE. So that's your social media update.
Yeah, actually, you know what's funny is I remember the 2012 race, Twitter and whatnot going on, and it wasn't really that popular. I mean, we had a system where the tracker would actually send stuff to Twitter, and it would update automatically every hour and whatnot. And there was actually quite a few people tweeting, but Twitter, I guess, wasn't really as big in January 2012. I don't know, I might be wrong on that. But then this season, it's just been a big deal. I remember Boothie actually during one of the rounds, I want to say it was Suzuka, just a social media guy for the race, because he was trying to control that, him and Jonathan Palmer both, while the race was going on, and also trying to admin the event.
Yeah, most of the time social media, problem with social media is it takes up more time than it's worth. You don't get much return from it, I don't think.
Yeah, I'm not a person to like social media, for example. I don't have a Facebook or anything like that. However, I do have a Twitter, but that's just to follow sports and racing. And I think that's kind of the same thing that's going on with MOE right now. You know, you have the race teams and also the drivers. You know, they want to follow what's going on. Best way to follow is Twitter, except for watching the live broadcast. Best way to follow would be Twitter. And a lot of the information that we can get from the teams is actually through Twitter at the end of the day.
Yeah, indeed. Is there any chance of the automated tweets coming back, or is that a bit advanced?
We have a completely different live timing system for racing. I can talk to Boothie about it. He can probably work up something. I'm actually surprised right now that the MOE website has not went down. During Race Spot 24-hour race, they didn't have any live timing or anything, and we honestly...
You hashed one for us, didn't you?
Yeah, we really was in the very early stages of making the MOE one, and I just got it working, to be honest, with teams and whatnot, and we wanted to test it. Best way to test it? Join a 24-hour race and do it. So after about 16 to 18 hours of it running, suddenly the website went down. Couldn't figure out why. And then Boothie comes back saying, yeah, I just used up all my bandwidth for the month.
Wow.
That one race. And the reason was, and not obviously his bandwidth at home, it's the server bandwidth. The reason, because we had it updating like every 5 seconds or something like that, something crazy like that. And it was really sweet because it almost looked like it was updating live, which it basically was. However, it was using a lot more bandwidth than when so many viewers are watching, or so many people hitting the live timing page, it just used a lot of bandwidth, and the next thing you know, boom, website's down. So this race, you've probably seen the live timing doesn't update as fast. It's updating, I believe, every 30 seconds. And this is simply because we don't want the website to go down. Plus, that's how a lot of people are watching the stream.
I think the peak, we had peak, I think we had about 750 people watching during the first 6 hours, and the website handled that with aplomb, so yeah, I think that was probably a worst case scenario, really.
Yeah, so we currently see Virgil Racing. I know we're talking about other things right now. However, Virgil Racing, 3.6 seconds. So they are slowly closing the gap.
Their charge sort of slowed, but they had a couple of laps where they're really on it. and I'm guessing just the tyres are mellowing a bit and they're not being able to push as much, but they are still the quicker of the two cars.
Also, just want to note the Spanish backing of MOE is pretty astounding. I have a Spanish backing myself, my last name Diaz and all. However, I don't read Spanish. I can read some of it, but I don't speak Spanish, that's for sure. And just the amount of Spanish stuff that we get on Twitter is amazing.
Yeah, I have to skip that, unfortunately, because I have no Spanish whatsoever. But we do appreciate it, though.
Yeah, one of them, for example, you know, saying that they just only slept 4 hours during the race. That's pretty cool to see.
I know that the guys from Iberica are a bunch that tweet all the time, really dedicated, but most of it's Spanish, so it's over my head. But like, irrespective of language and the nationality of your team, tweeting is fantastic because, of course, people of your own nationality will be able to read it, keeps them up to date, and any publicity is good publicity.
You could always use Bing to translate.
No, you can't. But like, it brings in more views, it gets more. That's what makes the grid so good, is having those people watching and wanting to take part.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, when I came back, because I'd not done any commentary for years, and when I came back, I was really blown away by how much interest there was in this series. So massively oversubscribed before it even turned the wheel.
Well, I was reading.
Amazing.
I was reading in the chat earlier that the official iRacing GT3 series last week had a much lower strength of field than normal because all the good people were practicing for Masters of Endurance.
Oh, damn, I should have raced then. Could have won something.
Yeah, it was quite humorous, actually. When we were first, like, we had this thing organized. I have a document from August 2011. It first started going into the works before GT3 even hit iRacing. You know, we were figuring out what to do and kind of just planning here and there. And when we first announced this, I'm not even kidding you, I originally had the restriction at 2500 iRating. And, you know, I thought that was actually kind of low. I was like, you know what, because I only wanted people who, you know, could produce good lap times and whatnot.
As it
were. Yeah, I had a really competitive series. And even if there's 30 cars racing, that's fine by me. However, Boothie talked me down into getting 1900. He gave me some stats to see how many drivers at the different iRatings. I think between 1900 and 2000, there was like an extra 6,000 people. So that's pretty big. So we lowered it down to 1900 iRating. And I thought there was going to be like 50 teams maybe total, and then maybe 35 to 40 race. Boothie was saying, maybe. And then Jorn Jens, after the first day of signups, I think there was, after the first day we had 45 signups or something like that, Jorn Jens said there was going to be 120 signups. Well, we're already over that by the third round, so yeah, over 130 signups currently. And there's only 60 slots per race, so you know, these teams are really putting in a lot of effort. Yeah, it's going to be 54 actually at Bathurst for the final round.
I don't think you want many more than 54 cars at Bathurst. It's a bit narrow.
Yeah.
Even then, that's a lot of damn cars at that track. Jeez.
Yeah, that's going to be...
Lewis, shall we sign up?
It's going to be a huge situation.
We should do two separate servers for the Bathurst one. No, maybe 54 separate servers. So everyone has their own space.
Have a system for each and every server, and then we can keep track of everyone.
That was done in Live for Speed, wasn't it?
The
16-hour race.
Yeah. Actually, there was up to 4 servers at one point, and everybody was actually racing against each other. There was 120 teams or something like that, all racing
against
each other.
Back in its heyday.
Yeah.
I do remember watching that. That was a little bit before I was competent enough to come last in those races.
Jake Sturgis for NX Racing Red X-ing the pits now. As you can see, Kloski just took the lead. Going to be short-lived. They're going to pit in the next lap here. Paul Ilbrink also in the pit lane for Radicals Online 2, which completely silent drive the past 12 hours. And pretty much been in the top 10 the whole time.
Yeah. So this will be the penultimate pit stop, so they'll have one more. And it'll be a quicker splash and dash towards the end of the race. Just under 2 hours to go now.
Virgil Racing also making a pit stop. I think they're doing a little bit here. I don't want to claim that. 25 lap stint, not bad. They're actually doing the exact same stint plan as Team Kimura. However, Team Kimura kept driving. Virgil Racing decided to pit. So they're about 6 seconds behind. Probably gained 2 seconds here on this outlap. Just want to see the top two. Ah, yes. There's a GT3. I believe there's all the... Yeah, those are all GT3 cars at Bathurst. It looks like 54 cars. That is going to be nuts. I actually have checked the first round, or the first and second round, and just watched basically the first lap from a TV cam that's kind of static and just, you know, watches all the cars go by. It is crazy to watch 60 cars go by and everyone be incredibly patient and not make any drag moves.
Yeah, at the more, like, now we've had three rolling starts in this series, I get more and more confident each time that Bathurst won't be an issue.
Yeah, I think it's just simply once they start hitting the mountain, if they mainly go single file from there, most likely on the first lap, they should be okay. It's when, you know, they're going to have to overtake sooner or later, and there's going to be overtaking in the mountain. I am really worried about that. However, I expect most of these people to be okay. I just went to Paul Ilbrink, who was definitely
yes.
Outside the track boundaries.
He was lapping Vortex Sim Racing there. Yeah, got a bit squirrely, but survived.
I think 54 people trying to pass each other over the top of the mountain at Bathurst. It's going to be pucker factor 8.5, I would think.
Yeah, it's going to be quite high. We also have a couple damaged cars. Don't worry, these guys aren't out of it. I mean, they can't win. Well, they could, technically, if everyone in front of them crashed. But Monster Energy Endurance and Mad Cow are actually racing for position. Believe it or not.
So that is for P31.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, both those. Bit of an action-packed race, as you can see from the the interesting damage on their cars.
Simon Trindle has done an extra pit just entered his pit stall now. So we should see Virgil Racing coming out, or coming about, I'd say 5 seconds behind, maybe down to 4 seconds behind them when they exit the pits here. Simon Trindle has already exited the pits. Oh, this is interesting. Wow. We saw earlier the roofs were a little slow in the pit stops. Actually, it's not that bad. I act like it's terrible, but 4.9 seconds, 4.8 seconds. takes Sturgis back to the lead. After Coan, the SimSport has pit.
Yeah, it's a 1:32 gap now.
Yeah, I think they don't have to worry about a pace, you know, any form of pace issues here.
No.
Jake Sturgis now in the car. He's probably the best guy to have in the next red car right now, as far as pace-wise. Also have Jack Sedgwick in NX Racing. Looks like he's doing a decent job holding off the Iberica Racing team. And I say that, and he gets a little oversteer moment there. So you know what that means. We're switching to somebody else. Don't want to jinx anybody.
Yes, indeed. So yeah, the first two drivers have now pitted. Third place is Core Motorsports. But they will, when they pit, they'll drop back. Actually, no, they'll stay in third.
Yes, Core Motorsports and then NX Racing Blue will be pitting right after them.
Yep.
And Iberica Racing Team's not that far after. Which, you know, now that I think about it, NX Racing Blue can also pit their way into the last stint as well. They may be pitting around. This is a rough guess, but I'm going to say 30 minutes remaining. So I don't actually think Iberica is going to get that close from just fuel alone on the pit stop, unless they don't change tires, and that would be very interesting. I don't think the roof can take that. That's a lot to ask.
That would be quite daring, yeah.
Yeah. I don't think it's worth the risk of doing that this late in the race. You know, take the points. Even if it's fifth place, you know, take the points.
So yeah, you're looking at Virgil Racing, Kimi Asumanimi, following Simon Trendle. They've both recently come out of the pits. Virgil Racing is the yellow and white and black roof. Simon Trendle, you can't quite see him at the moment, but he's between Virgil and the Team Camaro car. There is the leader currently lapping them.
Yeah, they're at a good pace at the moment, is that Virtual Racing car. The last lap they did, so they weren't really passing traffic or anything, but it was a 2:19.5. That's a fairly decent lap time to do at this stage. Obviously, they have got some fairly fresh rubber on that car, but that's a fairly decent time to do it at this point in the race, so. Yeah, it does look like they will be catching the car ahead, so definitely, you know, we'll keep an eye on this this Virgil.
Speaking of which, Jorn Jens just set Coanda SimSport's fastest lap of the race.
Oh, did indeed.
Not quite the fastest overall lap of the entire field, but one of the fastest laps of the race. It's a 2:18.28. And yeah, what a time to do it. But I guess in the fresh rubber that was helpful in his showing that he's got some pace.
Yeah, it's, you know, a message to NX Racing Red, if anything, to say that, well, we're coming, you know, we can give you a bit of a challenge. The first lap of the race, actually, is about half a second faster than that, which was actually set on the second lap of the race. You know, thousands of laps have been done since then, 556 completed by the leader, and not a single one has beat that lap set so long ago. Obviously, with traffic and stuff like that, it gets a bit harder to do the fast lap of the race. The Commander SimSport car's getting held up a little bit. Gets by anyway. And we'll try and close that gap in on NX Racing Red.
of a slower lap there from Colbert. The Birker Racing team lowering the gap to just about 18 seconds to NX Racing Blue.
Yeah.
This is what they're going to need to do if they want to challenge them at the end.
Yeah, I think from what I could tell from the tweet from Pablo Lopez earlier, it looks like they would like fourth if they can get it. Radicals Online just set there. 218.4. That's Paul Ilbrink, who's done that four laps into his stint.
Seen this tweet or not, this is actually the 53 car, not the 54, so I got a little scared there. But the 53 car of Team Camaro, their number one car, I guess you could say. Apparently they have a bent steering. Apparently a back marker has bent their car up.
A 52 car, that is it? Did you say?
The
53 car, yeah.
Yeah, apparently earlier in the race they had it where it was been a one way, and then thankfully they got it fixed, and then now it's bent the other way. So
yeah, in 28th at the moment. They are.
They should be able to live. It doesn't look bad. I think they'll be okay. But I am just saying that while sitting in my chair and not turning a or anything.
Yeah, a bit of armchair analysis there. Gap between the first two down to 1 minute 30. Consistently second faster each lap, Jorni Enns, compared to Jake Sturgis. But that's not enough. It would not be enough at that pace to overhaul them come the end of this race. An hour and 40 minutes from now.
Yeah,
not enough laps.
Way too tall of an order here. I mean, that's almost 2 seconds a lap they need, to be honest. So, it had to be a mistake to be made. I don't think we'll be seeing that, however. We also have Core Motorsports currently in the pits. We will be having NX Racing Blue overtaking them. However, not for long, as NX Racing Blue will be pitting soon as well. As you can see here, Core Motorsports exiting the pits now.
Yeah, that puts them just ahead on the road of Iberica, who pitted 18 laps ago.
So you can see him in the background right now.
Yeah, so you'd expect Core to pull away because of their fresh tyres.
That is correct.
But, like we say, Iberica will have a shorter final stint and therefore save plenty of time in their final pit stop.
Yeah, these cars, they have fuel and tires at different times, fuel first and the tires after. So if they have less fuel, obviously the pit stop's going to be much less time. So we shall see what's going to happen there. I think the top five, mainly P3 to... Well, actually, from P3 to P7, P6 and 7 could change. So P3 to P5 also could change.
I think it's like worth pointing out that with 1 hour and 40 minutes left on the clock, that's still longer than most races.
Still like nothing at this point. It's basically the finish line.
Yeah, this will be like, oh, just a sprint to the end. But like, in reality, particularly on iRacing with the official series, there are very... Well, in fact, I'd say with the official series, there are no races that go on for longer than this. So even at this stage, which we consider and the drivers on the track consider almost done, that's longer than most of them will be used to complete driving in a complete race. It's incredible when you think about just how long 24 hours actually is.
Yeah, a lot of these guys, the first time they will have done an endurance race, or that this is their first endurance series. So yeah, it's pretty cool, really. Pretty cool.
NX Racing Blue now in the pits. Next up will be Iberica Racing Team here soon. Probably in the next 5 laps or something.
Yeah, and that'll give them... Then they'll have one more stop after that.
Another one to keep an eye on is Virgil Racing. Slowly trimming their way closer to Team Camaro 2. Actually, we also have another battle on the circuit. Much closer. Scott Michaels running way too many hours in a row.
I can't believe that he hasn't. Are you sure they're not doing, like, swapping driver physically and not swapping it
in the
game? If so,
Michael Booth hasn't sent me the video yet.
Oh, do they have to prove it?
Yeah.
I see. Because, I mean, it is pretty absurd the amount of time they've got in.
Well, I mean, if he doesn't drive over 60%, it doesn't actually matter. But they have to prove that, you know, he hasn't driven over 60%.
Yeah. And how many has he got so far?
All I know is he can't go over 380 laps.
Okay. So he could pit at the end of this stint and he'd be alright.
It might be a little bit less than that. It could be 370. I'm not 100% sure. So yeah. If he pits this stint and gets out of the car, for sure he should be safe.
Scott Michaels going from side to side on Richard Hampstead, trying to get that 12th position around the outside of Blanchimont. Richard Hampstead pulls over to the outside of the second element of that corner.
Hey, if you remember earlier, they actually had a side-by-side moment in Blanchimont.
Richard Hampstead not keen to give up the place, but in the end, Scott Michaels had the line, and Scott Michaels now takes 12th position for R4R, as in, yeah, the team is called R4R.
Yeah, it's a good one to say, isn't it?
As soon as I started saying it, I thought, wait, this is not the best way of designing and talking.
Virtual Racing, actually, they had a slower lap last lap compared to Team Camaro 2. Another little battle going on here shortly, possibly, including Honic Racing Team and the 38 of Slow Finns, who have made their way all the way up to 21st.
They were like in the upper 40s at the beginning of the race, so they really... they've driven their sofa BMW pretty well.
I remember when we interviewed him, which doesn't even seem that long ago, but it definitely has been. He was there in 38th position.
They've yet to make use of their upside down MOE logo.
Hope they.
Didn't they
go
upside down early in the race? We had an interview with them.
Did they? Or maybe they did make use of it then.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. When we spoke to. I'm going to kick myself here. I forget who, but one of the guys from Slow Finns, they had mentioned an incident where they had been upside down quite recently.
Actually going to look to see who it was. None of those names are actually helping me out, all the ones that are currently in the server for them.
The drivers they have had are Jari Kokkola, Timo Toika, Antti Tuominen, Teppo Remes, Harry Sapala, and that's it, that's all of them. So it was one of those guys.
Yes, correct.
Or someone else, for that matter.
Maybe Racing Black looked like they just had a slowdown penalty. So they had to slow down pretty much the entire Kemmel Street.
I think Hellenic Racing Team in P22 is catching the slow Finns.
Just a little bit.
Yeah, about the last couple of days they've taken 2 seconds out of them for that 21st. The tracker is showing Hellenic Racing Team as having done 33 laps skint. That's obviously not correct.
Yeah, they lost connection and that's extended their stint.
Ah. Do you get a fresh car then when you disconnect?
Nope.
Ah, okay.
That's one interesting thing about iRacing. You don't, lose your lap and it keeps track of everything. And then also your damage, it also keeps track of all that.
Yeah, that's handy.
Watching Virgil Racing. Interesting to note about the 2 liters, actually. Notice anything about the gap?
It's gone up.
Yeah, it hasn't changed. If anything, it's gone up a bit. So.
Yeah, it's gone up by about 2 seconds.
I think both the drivers here have kind of figured out what's going on. Kind of accepted it. I know that, obviously, Commander are going to keep trying to push, because then if they keep pushing and an extra infield pressure, then they may push and that may lead to a mistake. So, that's their idea behind it, but I don't think that pushing is going to solve anything, really. Like, an X-Racing Red know that they just need to really just bring it home.
Next Red just lapping Hellenic Racing Team at the moment. Hellenic, yeah, still in the closest battle on track. They are still catching slow Finns.
Yes. 2.6 seconds behind currently. And behind them, I believe, is a Team Camaro car. Behind Hellenic Racing, that is. Yes, it is. Team Camaro car. See Virgil Racing right behind them. So Virgil Racing has pretty much a clear shot of looking at Team Camaro, currently 1.9 seconds behind.
Yeah, that's a proper battle, and because they're in sync in terms of strategy as well, this will be a battle that goes to the end. So Simon Trendle in 6th versus Kimi Asubanimi.
Better than I could.
Yeah, better not good.
Gonna go on board here with Kimmy.
That car directly ahead, you can see, turning into the bus stop, is the Team Camaro car. Now he's got a visual target. That should encourage him to speed up, and the gap is 1.9 over the line.
Yeah, the rabbit, as some would say. Always a great thing to chase.
Yeah, also that rabbit is currently stuck behind a BMW. mixed metaphor, but nonetheless true.
Just want to note that Jack Cedric has got out of the car for an X Racing Blue, and Robin has got in. So Robin most likely will be going to the end. We're going to do a short pit stop here at the end as well. Actually, we'll be pitting not very soon. They just pit 3 laps ago. Iberica Racing will be pitting within the next 4 to 5 laps.
If you are head to twitter.com/mastersofendu, we're about to tweet one final code for IGP Manager, one of the sponsors of the series. It's $50 worth of 2D pack, which lasts 1 year, at igpmanager.com. This race also supported by Blue Flag Racing, facebook.com/blueflagracing for them. And the series supported by Derek Spear Designs, providing track bosses to the winning team at the end of this season. The car ahead of the one we're running on board with is the Hellenic Racing Team of Nestoras. It's going to be lapped.
And yeah, he's actually only 1.3 seconds behind the car he's chasing.
Yeah, that was exactly what I was about to point out. They're actually quite close to position in 22nd and 21st. Placed about 421st against the slow Finns car number 38 and Hellenic Racing car 84. They're actually very close. Oh, wow.
That got a bit confusing as Chimera was lapping slow Finns. Slow Finns slowed right down, as is their name. Nearly ran to the back of him and had to take avoiding action and lost a load of time. And you saw all of that on board Virgil Racing, and very politely get out of the way, the slow Finns and All-Star Racing are right off to the outside of La Source.
I think
just letting everyone through.
They had a huge crash, so they're letting everybody by. One thing good about Spa's runoff is you can just kind of go out there and let people harming them in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah, so we've got the two battles on track are actually happening at the same part of the track at the moment. So for P21 and also a battle for P6. So you can keep an eye on both of those pretty easily. Currently on board with Hellenic Racing Team, chasing down the slow Finns. Jack Shedgewick, who just got out of the NX Racing blue car, came into the IRC channel and said, "Didn't crash. Result." So he obviously had his sights set fairly low for that stint.
If anything, those are sights set pretty high for Jack. He didn't roll. Yeah. Good day.
That's pretty much a win in his book. Even I have to congratulate him after the race for that.
Poor Jack. He does get abuse from sold LFSs.
But, I mean, he's accepted it. When you have a
true.
When you have a paint scheme that has text upside down on it, or says Av rolled, I mean,
You've given in.
Yeah, you have. And I just want to switch now to the battle for P6, because it is much closer.
Yeah, riding aboard Virgil Racing now. Kimi Esu Manimi is chasing that Chimera car of Simon Trendle. And yes, I think there could be a pass on going into La Source.
Don't think he'll fight it too hard.
He's braked. Oh, he's braked very nicely. Actually, nicely tucked it into the corner there. I think that was a good bit of driving from Trendle. Assuming Nimi has to find somewhere else to
I think you're about to see it here. Now, you can see the Virgil Racing car, the front end of it, a bit damaged. So, they probably don't have the straight line speed they've. I mean,
and the draft, they'll be okay. But then once they duck out, you'll see probably a huge amount of drag in the front of that car. Yeah, see, they weren't even able to get alongside them whatsoever. However, in the corner, it looks like Virgil Racing is far superior. I'm actually surprised that Team Camaro didn't put in. Been testing.
Yeah. Maybe they'll have him for the last stint, perhaps?
Possibly.
Quite possibly, indeed. Yeah, it's the kind of driver I would assume you should put in for this last stint if you want to secure yourself a position. If you want to secure sixth against that team, it's pretty good driver to put in that, but whether they do or not is up to them, of course.
I have at least 45 minutes, but who knows if Virgil Racing get around now, maybe they could build a gap and then Team Camaro kind of just gets settled into the seventh position. Don't know, really. I think this battle is definitely going to take its toll before a pit stop happens between these two cars.
Ahead of these guys, the new World SimSport Scarlet car had a spin at Pouin in the middle of the road, but luckily no one hit him. The leader went by, and he just about got away with it. Lost a bit of time on course.
Actually, there's a car in the pits. He might have actually hit the wall in the pits.
Oh, really?
I heard contact with the wall. It's funny, I hear so many different sounds in iRacing.
Oh yes, you're right. It was CTC Racing 2, Gernot Fritsch. Late decision to go into the pits, couldn't get the steering angle right, and yes, clouted the wall.
Wow.
On his way in.
It's one of those, I don't even know how that's possible, but yeah.
He went in, he pretty much went in for a 90 degree turn. He didn't take the actual official pit entry, he went over the blue line, the blue paint. So yeah. Did not work out.
You see in the background here, you're going to see Nesteros mostly having a run. Here he goes, ducking out to the outside.
Yep.
Slow Fins giving up that position.
That's P21 for Hellenic Racing Team. Slow Fins down to P22.
I was going to suggest that was going to be a move fairly shortly. No. How was the move down on the to this fight for 6th and 7th, the Team Camaro 2 car against Virgil Racing car, number 54 versus the number 2. Back on board with Virgil Racing.
The two cars ahead, you can see pulling over to the left to this ham racing.
Oh, that was nice right there.
Yeah, and New World SimSport Scarlet.
And just a heads up to people watching, there's no rule that says you have to go and just, you know, pull out of the way. Like, that's just common respect from the drivers and teams. They see a battle going on behind, they just get out of the way and let them battle it out. So huge amounts of respect to them. Could we see something here?
Yeah, possibly coming out of Blanchimont. Asubanimi has a good opportunity, but he has to lift off a little bit partway through the corner.
Yeah, a lot of aero push there.
Yeah.
See, he always gets a good run out. Oh no, the McLaren got a good run out of the corner too. Simon Trindle's been no slouch this season as well. We say been testing, but Simon Trindle has definitely not been any slouch.
He's doing an absolutely fantastic job to keep that Virgil Racing behind him. He's just doing everything right. He's not like diving around the track or anything like that. He's just keeping calm, keeping to his line, braking maybe a little bit later than he would by himself, and just keeping everything under control and everything at a calm pace for him. It's working well at the moment, and he's doing a fantastic job in that McLaren.
I think he's actually one of the drivers that, much like, you know, the core motorsports guys, very quiet. He doesn't make
many passes, mainly because he's catching up to the cars. And then once he's caught up, Ben Testing then gets into the car and catches up, you know, the rest of the way and makes the moves. So that's why we probably haven't mentioned him as much this season. However, we've seen him every single round so far, and he's performed very well every single round. If you guys are wondering why we're having a moment of silence while watching this, it's because we're all very, very interested in it. We're just watching these two cars battle it out.
In NASCAR, they call that the sound of speed, don't they, or whatever? What do they call it?
Well, you know, we're gonna have to make it more entertainment-like, so it's turn it up. Or crank it up.
Let's crank it up.
Isn't it the, the sprint?
Don't correct me, I'm American.
Isn't it the sprint crank it up?
Sponsored by Need for Speed or
it's
something?
Sponsored by something. I mean, it's NASCAR.
Well, it ain't gonna be Sprint anymore. So get ready for, like, the Walmart Cup or something like that.
I hope it's great. Something really silly. Cup. Like, oh, no, wait. What I just thought of, I probably can't say on stream, so.
Viagra? We just had to have a nice little chat with each other in private, because
I'm not allowed to say anything what I just said on the stream.
No.
That were just discussed. NASCAR could be going down an interesting route. Some people may like it. Yeah, some people may like it. Definitely introduce some new types of people to NASCAR.
The adverts between segments would be more interesting.
Yeah, might make some of it easier to watch.
Yeah, that's the main thing, really, is the adverts. We actually see a car off to the left there.
Yeah, that is Vortex Simracing 114, Michael Claude, P38. That was Stavolo. He lost it by himself.
Looks like Virtual Racing's kind of just gotten comfortable here, and I think I know why. I think they're going to pit one lap sooner. And when they do that, they're planning on jumping. If they don't pass before then.
Yeah, so, looks about right.
I think they're just going to ride on the bumper here and wait for that moment.
So, Iberic pitted. So yeah, they're going to be maybe a 45 minute and then a half hour, perhaps? Or 40.
I don't know if they cut it like that. They might just try and extend as far as possible and have like a 15 minute sprint. I have no idea. I think most likely what you just said, splitting it in half, in my opinion, would be quickest. Simply because, think of like GT3 racing. When they do GT3, the 90-minute races that they did, or 75-minute race they did, which is pretty much this right now, you split it in half, and that's the fastest way. So if they did that, mad props. If they did not, I don't know what to tell them.
Got an hour and 17 to go in this race. NX Racing Red leads the field by a minute and 30. Commander Sim Sport in second. Core Motorsports third. Fourth, NX Racing Blue. Fifth, Iberica Racing Team. Six. Team Camaro 2, 7th Virtual Racing, who we're on board with right now, 8th Radicals Online 2, 9th Mad Cow Racing 2, and 10th Pure Racing Team number 1.
Currently trying to figure out, actually, 8 laps in between NX Racing Blue and Iberica. 8 laps, you would normally think 2 seconds a lap. I don't think it'll be 2 seconds a lap. However, if it was, 8 times 2, that's 16 seconds. It's currently a 14 and a half second gap. It will most likely shrink due to, as we see, Virgil Racing going to be
that's awkward.
Left out here. They lost some time from that. This is also kind of why we like to do some onboards, because then you get to see what the team experiences during that moment.
That was QTRS P36, just unable to find a good place to let them through, but it's through now without any damage done.
Yeah. But I believe, and Iberica is also going to have the fresh tires here, so they're going to close in probably 2 to 3 seconds before Rock Ops and NX Racing Blue make their final pit stop. I don't know, it's going to be close.
Yeah, and Iberica is just coming up on these. The guy you're on board with, behind him is the Iberica car of Jesus Cecilia, who will be coming around to lap him. Ooh, there's loads of cars up ahead there. Ooh, that's got a bit awkward.
Simon Trindell, Team Camaro, just made a fabulous move. Got around 2 cars, and now he's going to set sail here for a little while.
That was well timed. Yeah, he got past Mad Cow and Motorsports in one go.
Actually, since this has happened, let's look around the track. Give everyone a little break of that. Currently, the looking at the leader, NX Racing Red, Jake Sturgis behind the wheel. And you'll see, 29 seconds behind is Jorn Jens for Coan Simsport. If you're wondering how fast they're really going, you're going to have to go back. You're going to actually have to look at this manually. It's going to say 2 laps in between Jorn Jens and Core Motorsports. However, I don't know if that's really true. Core Motorsports is ahead of them this lap. I believe it's going to be 2 laps, or a lap and a half, and not actually 2 laps. So that's just how far ahead the top 2 cars are versus the rest of the field.
It's a very solid drive from both teams there, and you know, just darting around all of this traffic in. It's been a bit of a problem for a couple of teams, but you know, most of the time they've been all right. But you know, lap traffic is always, in my opinion, in sim racing in general, based on previous experiences, that it's just the most terrifying thing is when you come up to a lap car, especially for, I mean, Sturgis is probably quite used to it now. I'm sure all of them are, and all of them would have been prior to this event. But even then, when you're in the lead of a race, when you're comfortably leading it as well, and you're coming up to backmark, and you're just like, one of these, I don't know what they. You know, they could cut across me at the first turn and end my race. And that's, you know, I find it's terrifying coming up to back markers because I find them very unpredictable. But it doesn't seem like it's been so much of a problem today for these guys, which is always good to see.
Oh man. What? I did not want to just see that.
That was close.
Yeah.
Well, it looked close on the stream. In real life, or at least on my screen, it looked less adventurous. Yeah,
bit
of a
went on the AstroTurf there, and it looked like he was on ice for a minute.
It was the angle as well that made that a bit scarier to see as well. I'm sure in the car he probably wasn't really like too noticing of that. He just sort of drove around it as if it didn't happen.
Yeah, Core Motorsports, they seem to have everything covered.
And in my opinion, they are not, you know, the fastest roof, for example, out there. They're just the most consistent. I mean, that's probably the simplest way to put it. Virgil Racing, I don't think they've got a penalty this race. If they have, my apologies for not remembering that. They have, however, had a timeout. And yes, they did have a penalty, I remember now. That's why they have front-end damage. And then you have the Iberica Racing car in fifth. They have had two drive-throughs, and I believe they also said they had two stop-goes. So they've really had two stop-goes as well. That's pretty amazing to see them. But it's just a simple fact of the matter is, Core Motorsports, they've had no penalty. They're the ones that have been hit, and they've just been cruising all on their own, minding their own business, doing their own race, and that's why you see them in third right now.
That's all about that. To be honest, that is all about motorsport all the way around. And it's something that Oscar keeps telling me whilst doing some racing, is that sometimes it's just not the fastest driver that wins or the fastest team that wins. It's the most consistent, especially in endurance racing. It's all about consistency. You know, we're not in qualifying. Sure, the fastest guy is going to take P1, as Benito has done for Team Redline across the season.
Qualifying counts for nothing if you crash.
Exactly. And they have won how many races this season?
Zero.
Exactly. And it's all about consistency in this championship. And Core Motorsports is doing a very, very good job at showing that today. Currently running in that P3. It's a fantastic job for them at the moment.
Yeah, it's you basically just hit the nail on the head, to be honest. The only GT1 race I've ever won, MOE, because it used to be GT1, GT2. Actually, it used to be only GT1 before that. But when it was GT1, GT2, I was to win the 24 hours, in 2011. And that was literally just all consistency. There was nothing more on that team besides consistency. We didn't have the speed. We were actually one of the people in our team, Oscar for sure, or actually Michael Passacamblemon as well. Mark Bumby.
Yeah.
He was a person where, I don't know if anybody has a team. Sorry about that. Virgil Racing and Team Camaro side by side.
Are we getting close?
Yes. I have to finish the story later. But he's a person on a team that uses no force feedback and turns the wheel way too much. And therefore, we had to make a setup around him more than anybody else. And in endurance racing, you guys will learn that. You have to build setups for people on your team. Everyone has to be able to use it. And it mainly just adapting to...
Which upsets me, because I run... Well, compared to everyone else, I don't run any brake pressure.
That is true.
I'm one of those people that... I don't know, it's just my driving style. Ooh, as we see a lot of defending here. My driving style, I make it to where a car will just oversteer. No matter how understated it is, it's just how I drive the car, and I make it oversteer. And that's a big problem with me, because someone like Simon Cattell, for example, he'll set up a car to be pretty oversteer speed, and that will kill me.
Because you're already driving it sideways.
Exactly.
And then it's got that snappy nature to it at the same time. You're just ruined.
Exactly.
Which is why sometimes you need to team up with people of your driving style as opposed to people you like.
Exactly.
So no, in neither way will I team up with Oscar.
That's what we did for the 2011 race, and it really helped. There were two other teams that we were competing with, all finished within a minute. Ooh, as we saw a mistake there. And here comes Virgil Racing on the inside. This might be the move. No.
Yeah, I think it might. Oh, it's doing a side by side. Okay, so that's going to go. Oh.
Hey, this might be a 24 hour race, but we're about to have a good action here with 1 hour left.
It's really, really good work from Trundell in that Team Camaro 2 car to have kept that car behind for so long. You know, we say so long of the race. It's actually a really small percentage, but
He hasn't really been doing that much to do it as well.
No, he's just been keeping to himself. The thing is, though, is if he was defending aggressively, if he was, like, you know, holding the inside track, he probably would have lost the position by now.
Exactly. But he's I think the same thing.
Yeah, he's just keeping to himself, and that's the most important. It's showing that sometimes the easiest way to defend is just to keep to your line. Keep your eye on that mirror to see where they're going to dive bomb and everything like that, but just keep to your line. It's the fastest way around the track, and it has been for you in qualifying and the race. And so, you know, just keeping to that is what's going to keep that defensive work up, basically.
There's a time and a place for aggressive defending, but it's not with 1 hour and 5 minutes left of a race. It's in a 15-minute race or a 20-minute race, and, you know, then you completely to the inside line to defend. And, like, then that, even then, when you do start defending, there is a right and wrong way of doing it, and not defending at all is certainly an effective means when everyone's running so close like this.
It's going to be interesting here. Virgil Racing, let him get back in line before Eau Rouge.
There's just a healthy amount of respect between the two drivers at the moment, just, you know, trying to race but show each other the respect of not trying to go side by side up through Eau Rouge and whatnot. You know, you don't want to risk it that much.
I'm gonna jump back on board here because I think he has a very strong run. Lecombe down to, sorry, it's turn 8. I know that. What was a little just there because of the late braking. Just want to mention the battle between NX Racing Blue and Iberica Racing Team. I don't know, maybe Racing Team's trying to save fuel. There's no way they can save 15 minutes. That ain't gonna happen. However, they are running a little bit slower than NX Racing Blue right now, which is at the end of the race. Gap currently went up a second from 14 to 15 seconds in the past 6 laps. And from what I can tell, it's going to be about a 6-lap splash of fuel for Iberica Racing Team. It'll be very interesting to see if they get tires or not, because tires are 16 seconds. However, if you're only going to lose 2 seconds a lap, then maybe it's worth it. It's just you're going to have to drive extremely competitive. And if you get caught up and you're going to try to push, it's going to be a huge problem. So if it matters if you want to be the or the defender for Iberica Racing Team.
Yeah, I think a lot of drivers prefer to be ahead, just because you already have it, it's yours to lose, whereas having to fight and gain it, I don't know, you're less in control of the situation, I think. Although if you've got fresh tyres. Oh, and Team Camaro just had a slowdown. That made it very easy for Virgil Racing to go past for 6th position.
Yeah, that's big there. And he still has the slowdown. Is it gone yet? It's gone. Oh, no. He needs to make sure he serves it here soon. Sometimes if you try to risk it like this, it ends up getting worse for you. Looks like it's completely served now. Lost about 2 seconds in the process. How far he was up in front to how much he's lost now. I think this has kind of sealed it for Virgil, because they were faster in my opinion. They also were able to pit earlier and bump him in the pits. Team Camaro, that is. And I mentioned Iberica Racing Team, how they need to push, and Jesus Cecilia just ran 1/10th their best lap time. 10th and a half, actually, off their best lap time so far today.
Yeah, it's 1.6 seconds faster than NX Racing Blue's same lap.
It's Their best lap time is at 18.40. So Jesus is definitely pushing. That's actually six, seven laps into their stint. So it's not like it's, you know, right off the start. I guess he just had a clear lap last lap. His fastest car on track by a second, actually, last lap. And he just did the same thing again. Just ran an 18.589.
Say to them, if you're running that well this many laps in, respond to Innex Racing Blue, pit when they pit, and carry on just trying to eat away at their gap on equal terms.
They might do that. They did, you remember last round, that's what they did, and it ended up paying off. So they may do the same thing this time around, who knows. They will catch them though, because they do have to take much less fuel.
Another slowdown for Team Camaro.
Oh, that's not good. Simon Trindell is pushing a lot.
Yeah, I mean, now they're down to seventh. The car behind them is 38 seconds away, so they can probably just afford to coast it to the end.
Yeah, they just need to conserve their stuff. Paul Obenk will be pitting a couple laps earlier, so he's going to be a little bit quicker. He'll only gain probably 5 seconds before Camaro makes their pit stop. So it should be comfortable. Battle for the lead. Still 1 minute 30 seconds between NX Racing Red and Go-Am SimSport.
So we're now officially into the last hour of this race. All the previous hours that have come before no longer matter, it's all about this one.
It's been probably the longest 23 hours of my life. Probably the same thing for most teams that are still running.
Yeah, big respect to you and obviously everyone else as well. So with an hour to go, just a quick rundown of the top 10. Innex Racing Red lead by a minute and a half. Commander SimSport are behind them. Cool Motorsports in third, two laps down. Innex Racing Blue fourth, Iberica fifth, Virgil Racing 6th, Team Camaras 2 7th, Radicals Online 2 8th, Mad Cow Racing 2 9th, and Pure Racing Team 1 is in 10th position. Final stop for Team Camaro 2, Team Camaro 1, sorry. Trying to enter the pit lane.
That is actually Camaro 2.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's a little weird. It's their quicker team, it seems like, but their number 2 car.
Yeah, they're labeled differently in-game and in the timer.
I see what they're trying to do here. They're going to try... They're short-pitting, and they're going to try to gain off back on Virgil Racing. Interesting to see if Virgil Racing try to cover that and pit this next lap. Kind of like a Formula One type thing right now, trying to undercut people.
What if they go for a driver swap?
Doesn't look like it. Simon Trindle's going to continue until the end. Wow. I was lied
to. It's Ben Tusting.
Yeah, Ben Tusting just jumped into the car. It was late, a little late on the driver swap there.
Can that happen at any time during the pit stop, or does it have to be
Yes, it can happen at any time.
Okay.
I think the general consensus is to try to do it before your tire change has begun. Or if you're in other cars, you do it after the tire change is finished. Gonna look to see if Virgil Racing pit this time. Quite possible that they will, but not sure.
There's no reason not to. They want to stay ahead of Camaro. Yep.
Yep, there we go. See a lot of strategy even in the final hour of the race.
Yeah, I guess it's just a case of not being surprised by Kimura being quick and undercutting them. So yeah, it's probably for the best.
Well, saw a pass there, which technically wasn't fully on track. However, you see Dylan Sharman for Team GTL just passed Scott Michaels. Technically for position, Scott Michaels was exiting the pits, and you see Iberia three wide. Actually, now two. Going to try to pass all those cars. Oh, they succeeded.
Nicely done. Still in fifth place.
They have gained on an iRacing blue. I think that's going to be another one that's going to be very close.
I think it's a very good move by Camaro 2 to put testing back in the car, because he's sort of been their fastest guy so far in the race, and maybe keeping the dream alive in terms of battling with Virgil.
Yeah, Virgil Racing just finally made it to their pit stall. Paul Elbrink and Anders Dahl is getting thrown into the Virgil Racing car.
Ah, so similar response from Virgil.
Few tweets. Just the one for now, actually. Team Camara just tweeted they're starting to run out of fingernails at this point. And they tagged Virgil Racing in it as well. And that was just before, in fact, Virgil Racing passed them after the slowdown.
Radicals also just made a driver change. Anthony Roselli, and for the 55 minutes of the race. Here we go. Anders Dahl just took off now. Currently still under pit road speed limiter. Now just taking off.
This will be close.
Now the Camaro 1 car just passed. The Camaro 2 car
is going to be side by side, and he's going to have the momentum. The Camaro car.
Oh, boosh. Easy. This is big now. See what could happen here.
Yeah, Bavergia will have that fresh tyre, and Dozdal will have the a lap advantage. So he's got to make the most of this outlap.
Wow, smart move there from Camara. Not only that, but I would think that this is going to be a pretty even fight in terms of Ben Testing and Anders Dahl. They're both incredibly talented guys.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting, actually. We might see Ben Testing pull away at the beginning of this. However, the McLaren's front tires, or even the rear tires, might give way just a tiny bit. We'll see here shortly to see what happens. Also noticing that Scott Michaels, who looks like he's going to be driving the final stint. Don't know how that's going to work, to be honest.
Well, they must have been doing driver swaps. Like physical driver swaps.
Hopefully they can prove it, else they will most likely be losing laps for going over the limit. Currently in a battle. That is a battle for position that you see on screen.
Do they just have to prove they've done it once?
No, they're going to have to prove the time codes that they did it, so we know how long. Or just the lap numbers even. If they didn't do that, then how
race leaders in the pit lane.
Jinkster just going to be pitting for the final time.
Just coming out.
Sport should be following. I guess not this lap, they're going to be going to the next lap. Once again, R4R and Team GTL really close. Final 3 hours, really, it's been like this at the end of their pit cycles. See Dylan Sharman letting Scott Michaels go.
So it looks like Ben Testing has the pace on Anders Dahl and is pulled away for P6.
I think we're going to see this, I'm going to say, for the next 5 laps or so. Maybe even get the gap all the way up to 2 seconds, unless Anders Dahl can stay in the draft. And then after that, I think Anders will have a slight advantage. Roof seems a little bit better than the McLaren on the long run, if they can preserve the rear tires. which we actually spoke to Anders Dahl earlier, and he said that teams kind of made the setup a little bit more cautious on the rears, trying to save them for later in the stint. See the slow fins getting out of the way for these two. Looks like Scott Michaels had pretty carefully, I say carefully, over Team TTL. R4 had just made a pit stop 2 laps ago. Team TTL still another 10 laps until they pit, 9 to 10 laps.
Fastest lap of the race for the Camara 2 team, Ben Tusting setting their fastest lap, their personal best. 219.073. Compared to the other fastest lap of the race, it's actually not very fast at all. But they're still in 6th place, so it doesn't really matter.
Coanda pit out of the lead, which will be giving the lead back to NX Racing Red.
Yeah, that's our last stop of the race. There they go. So all being well, that's NX Racing Red to the end.
See Jake Sturgis, heard him talking the other day. He said he's, even though he does DWC and whatnot, which is hour and a half long races, he's not really that comfortable with doing double stint, which is basically 2 hours. I don't know if maybe the last 30 minutes or so, he's just so used to DWC, but after an hour and a half, maybe the last 30 minutes, he kind of loses concentration. But as we can see here, he's been so far so good.
Endurance race I did recently, I triple stinted.
Yeah, triple stints. I mainly like the double stints. I think I'm actually better in the second stint, especially at the start.
The double's alright, because if you've got the ability to maintain concentration, you actually tend to find that the second hour, you've found where your groove's at, and you can do it not necessarily with faster outright laps, but more consistent laps over that second hour than the first.
Yeah, for sure. I think maybe the end of the second, I think that's when I'm a little bit more conservative, which is not really the worst thing in the world.
Remember back in the LFS days where you had the fast 3 or 4 laps at the beginning of a stint?
Change them on the fly.
GP3
cars, I'm pretty sure they can do that. To Dennis Lynn, he raced in ELMS, the GT3 cars.
Oh, of course
there.
He did, didn't he? He was in a 458, so.
Yep, and he said you were able to do that, so maybe I can ask iRacing if they have any plans for that. Maybe we can see those next season in MLE.
I know that that's possible with the V8 supercars in iRacing, isn't it? The actual bar adjustments.
I'm pretty sure, and also, well, actually, no, the F1 car does diff changes. I don't know about anti-roll bars. I want to say there's at least one car that does anti-roll bars. I want to say like the HPD or something, but I'm not too positive on it. Maybe someone
in
the crowd
race,
can answer.
I don't race iRacing enough to know properly.
Want a little update on Iberica Racing. If you're wondering what's going on with them, are they catching NX Racing Blue? Yes, they are. Currently 8 seconds back.
Almost a second that last time by. A DW12 apparently does anti-roll bars in iRacing.
Ah. Most people are looking and probably thinking, wow, 8 seconds, it's a big gap. However, Iberica Racing will be doing a short pit here at the end. So, NX Racing Blue will be pitting in roughly 4 laps, if not less, possibly less. And when they do that, we'll see Iberica Racing team possibly doing only a few more laps, and then they're going to have to take much less fuel.
Yeah, and then they'll
gain a lot of time.
Yeah, they'll have less fuel and fresher tyres when they pit later, so it could that could work very well in their favour. Depending on who drives NX Racing Blue and who's driving the Iberica car.
Just going to check the gap between two top cars after both pit stops have been done. Once again, minute 30 seconds. It's definitely come down. We'll probably see it come down another 5 seconds here with Martin Kronk in the car now for a Coanda Sim Sport.
Yep.
Martin's done a stellar job for them. So is Rins Brokman, also Andre Butcher, Jorn Jens, Marcus Lindemann, and Klaus Kivikas. All 6 of those drivers have drove Coanda Sim Sport car today. And last night and yesterday. So want to jump to this real quick. Here it all's fallen to 1.8 seconds back.
Car ahead, Camara, Ben Tusting, is just coming up behind the Monster Energy Endurance car. Not entirely sure why, but my iRacing has stopped showing which driver is in which car.
Yes, yours just did that too?
Yeah.
Interesting.
I'm just seeing team. Here we go.
Thankfully, we still see them in the overlay. Ooh, as you see Virgil Racing losing a little bit of their rear grip, exiting the corner there. I'm gonna give a shout out real quick to everyone's favorite animal, skin, or paint, Mad Cow Racing, number 2, only in the 10th position.
That's really good. The Mad Cow 2 has stayed out of trouble.
We haven't really seen them in anything. I mean, they've been in some battles, but they've kept it rather clean. Oof, this fourth place battle. I don't think NX Racing Blue is going to be able to hold this one off. 6.3 seconds.
Yeah, that's going to be a tough one.
Here's the second last lap, 8 tenths of a second.
Just looking at the 70% distance, what do you reckon that is lap-wise?
For the score points?
Yeah.
400... hold on, Michael Boots said something earlier, I'm going to guess. 420 to 430, somewhere in that range.
Okay. So we have a few cars that have retired that will still score points for the position they're classified in. Ator 80 in 39th, Pure Racing Team 2 in 40th, in 41st, and Dream Factory in 42nd. They will score, well, they should score points for their respective classification positions.
We see Core Motorsports in the pits right now for their final time. Done a driver swap.
Oh yeah, Danny Gooser for the final stint.
I believe he made a tweet about it, actually.
Yep.
He's quite excited to do the final stint. We even see, I mean, just for now, Danny's going to come out of the pits here, and he's actually behind both Iberica Racing Team and NX Racing Blue. Both still have to make pit stops, so not exactly a big deal. Just want to make sure they kind of just, you know, mind their own business, which Core Motorsports, I shouldn't say that, because we already know that they're going to.
Yeah. Now my iRacing has stopped showing positions as well, because I'm gonna close it and reopen it, I think.
Actually, you know what? Mine has too.
Hmm.
Yeah, this is a interesting situation here. It's still scoring though in live timing. That's all I'm really worried about. So it looks like our interfaces in iRacing while spectating started to fall apart. Michael Passingham is going to try to rejoin the server and see if that fixes the issue.
If everyone else is having the issue, it probably won't help in the slightest, but, you know, turn off and on again.
To jump to Anders Dahl here, who... 1.1 seconds. Starting to close it back in. Trying to get the draft of the car in front of me. That's Hellnick Racing Team. Yes, it is. Just want to note that after 24 hours, there's still a couple positions that could easily change. And by that, I mean, we're seeing it right now. NX Racing Blue enters the pits, and guess what? So does Iberica Racing. They're doing the exact same thing that they did last round.
That's the call that I would have made in their shoes.
This is a big move here. Going to be on the same tires, essentially the same fuel. Hopefully, both teams make the correct fuel numbers. Assuming they have. I know if Simon Cattell is awake right now. I'm actually going to look to see if he is. Interesting. No, he's not. He is not in there. However, Isaac Price is, and he's not currently driving. Therefore, Yes. I believe that they should be fine.
They get away at the same time, Iberica ahead.
Yes, that's... So that's, I think that may game set match there for Iberica Racing Team.
Yeah. I wonder how they did that.
Less fuel. Less fuel. Yeah. More recent pit stop.
That's a good point. Yeah.
And we see a Spanish uproar in spec chat.
Again, it's the right decision because they've got that lesser fuel, so they can risk making the jump in the pit stop, which they have done. And then they're on completely level footing now with NX. So it's all down to who's quicker. And over the past, well, couple of hours, it's been America overall. So
yeah, they tried the same thing last race, and it turned out that when they came out of pits, it was pretty much bumper to bumper. However, NX Racing Red was ahead of Iberica Racing Team. And then some different things transpired. NX Racing Red made a slight mistake exiting the corner, and Iberica Racing Team was able to get around and go on to the victory, which after a 1,000-kilometer race, which is roughly 6 hours, separated by, I believe, a second.
Nice and close.
Yep.
So the Mad Cow Racing Team 1 car, otherwise known as Daisy, is out. Brake failure, apparently.
Brake failure?
Not entirely sure. Maybe someone's pedals broke, possibly, or... Not really sure, but either way, they're now classified 36th, will score. And also, All-Star Racing Team appear to have ended their run.
Yeah, it looks like that the number 114 car is going to try to steal at least one of those positions. I think he's going to be able to steal the number 3 position. Kind of see there that NX Racing Blue lost about 5 seconds, or sorry, 7 seconds. My math was a bit off there. 7 seconds in the pits from the fuel alone.
So you just seen in IRC, the brake failure was actually pedals, like actual real life pedals stopped working.
Wow. Well, if it makes them feel any better, they're pretty close to the end of the race and they probably won't lose a position. And they weren't going to gain a position either anytime soon unless somebody had a huge incident.
The other Mad Cow car, I didn't realise this, is known as Buttercup, the McLaren. And that car's still
so
up there.
So we have Daisy and we have Buttercup?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
In ninth position.
They've done a great job. We actually have another little battle here for the 23rd position, number 60 of Trinity Motorsport, and number 77. See Core Motorsport just behind them.
Yep, and that is for 23rd. Gap's 0.8. Drivers, like, this is very difficult because the drivers have been scoring, so it isn't working for me.
Ah, good. So you, even rejoining, you can't see anything?
Didn't help. I think the server's just bork. And, Trinity Motorsport car goes past. That's Patrick Bieri passing Antti Tuominen. No, it's not. It's Nesteras in the Hellenic race. No, it's... See what happens when I have the data. It's Mika Lirki, who's just been... passed by Trinity Motorsports, I think.
Well, they haven't actually made a pass yet. I'm actually just going to call him by their... team name right now, because I can't say anything more. Marlboro Motorsport currently trying to catch Trinity Motorsport. And just a random update here, Robin Frischkops for NX Racing Blue has actually got within a second of the Iberica Racing Team, Jesus Cecilia. I think this is literally just 100% traffic playing a role here. 1.3 seconds gained last lap alone.
Yeah, you can see the car is, and there's a gap of, there's a KRT car between them.
Whoa.
Wow.
That
HRT car did not leave much room at all.
No, I think he was thinking he might go to the left, but nope. He chose the right. Friscott took the right, and it was almost a disaster.
Oh, Team TTL swerve off to the right. Let's see if they also... No, they don't. But the next racing... It's a problem when you're following somebody from a little bit around a second back. Lapped cars aren't going to help both of you sometimes if you're just waiting too long. Over here you see Team TTL, Dylan Charman, being nice and polite, letting them through. Dylan currently not in the closest of battles with anyone around him. 12 seconds to the closest car to be exact.
Yep.
So we have 30 minutes to go here. And just look at the quick rundown of the results at the bottom of the screen. Also, you have the ticker along the top. However, that's just not enough, so let's go with more. Well, the Friscott's was actually a really good time last lap, even though he had the lapper issue. Currently 0.8 seconds behind, so he should have the slipstream. Shouldn't be able to make any form of move on the Kimmel straight unless Siberia can make a pretty large mistake. They are going to close them massively here. Goes all the way to about half a second. So gained about 3, maybe 4 tenths. Down from La Source all the way to Lacombe. Heads up, not only is this battle here very close, but also Andersdal within a second of Ben Testing. Don't worry, if they get any closer, we will them as well.
So that roof sort of coming back to Anders as we expected it might do.
As long as he protects the rear tire, should be okay. Half a second in between these two cars on your screen, about for the fourth position, Iberica Racing Team and NX Racing Blue. Both teams surely quite nervous right now, to say the least.
Yep, and just over 27 minutes to go in this 24. Nice to get in one last position at the end. We still have been fighting in this top five for the entire race.
Should have a little bit of a run here. I don't think it's going to be enough to actually challenge Iberica Racing Team.
Yeah, you put them maybe alongside as they go into the braking zone, but it won't be enough.
Iberica Racing Team's going to give him the outside, that's about it.
So he cuts back, Friscott's, and now can't get a great run out of Lacombe as they head down to Bruchelles.
think the only thing Robin can do right now is just push the rear team to a point where they possibly overheat their rear tires. And then, you know, you have to slow down for that, obviously. Trying to crash.
Yeah, we'll force them into a mistake. Which is easy to do around these long flowing corners. You just take a slightly incorrect entry and you wash out to the outside.
Yeah, so we're taking an incorrect entry and have to make a little bit of a correction. When you do that, these cars can get very light on the rear end and suddenly around.
If in doubt, flat out. It's the only way to guarantee downforce.
Well, would be if these things were utilising ground effect. Which they're probably not doing very much of. Drive the Lotus 79 on iRacing and you have to drive it about 20 miles an hour faster everywhere than you think it's feasibly possible to go.
This could be a chance for Friskops. He's looking, probably he'd have to look to the outside, he'd have to brake extremely late. And nope, Cecilia keeps that inside line defended into bus stop, but then has a bit of a compromised entry into the second part, but Friskops can't do anything about it and gets held up a little bit and has to think about something else.
And a tough situation there is the fact that they can't get on the throttle the same. BMW's not going to be able to get on the throttle as good as the roof. Something that Trinity Motorsports is under fire from Marlboro.
It's got a great run. Friskops has got a very good run out of Radion. If he goes to the outside here, if he breaks a little later, but it really is going to be a case of breaking a little too late. And he breaks at the same time, and Cecilia gets back in, but he continues to hug around the outside, then into the inside for the next part, and yep, Cecilia couldn't quite hold it around the outside and is down to fifth. That puts NX Racing Blue up into fourth. Good battle. We thought the balance of power had shifted to Iberica, but in the end, Friskops just had the pace.
Anders Dahl getting ever closer to testing as well. That's now down at just about 0.3 seconds.
Yes, down at Bruchel for 6th place. Now that 4th place battle has been resolved.
We actually saw a spin there.
Yeah, who was that? That's Phoenix Motorsports. Down in 13th position.
This looks like they've now fallen back to 14th. So they lost the spot to Dylan Sharman and Team TTL. Just going to flip to Anders Dahl real quick. For racing. Very similar situation that Robin Friskops was just in.
Got some provisional points for you. If the results finish as they are, NX Racing Red would take the championship lead by 30 points, by 45 points, sorry, over Core Motorsports. And Coralia SimSport would be in third, 6 points behind Core Motorsports. Now, Iberica would be fourth, and Team Camaro 2 would be up in fifth. Run a bit wide there, did the Team Camerica.
Big run here for Anders Dahl, but he's going to have to back out most likely before Rouge. Don't see him going for it.
Oof.
He kept it there. He wanted to keep an awkward line. Been testing. And he actually did, because now he's going to have a run.
Yeah, it'll be a...
Ooh, it doesn't seem that much, actually.
No, that's weird, actually.
That McLaren is quite trimmed out, and we also have to remember that there is front-end damage on... Virgil Racing car, which he's going to make a duck on the inside.
That was late.
Yes.
Had to cut a little bit of the inside of the track to avoid a collision, but it was an interesting attempt. I'll have to try somewhere else.
Then testing was already ready for a move here, as we saw Simon Trindle have to defend earlier in Virgil Racing.
Down to just under 21 minutes to go.
Yes, and also Marlboro have got around. Yeah, and if anything happens to the Max Racing red car, it's not like they can really thing up. There's no time. Just flip to see what Iberica Racing team they run wide. Next thing, Eau Rouge lost a bunch of time. They still have the draft, but lost a bunch of time. They're actually not even going to gain here. However, just ahead of NX Racing Blue, there are four cars.
Yeah, maybe that battle isn't over. Scott's decisively passing those cars.
He has to watch out here. He made that move and it was a little aggressive, and as you can see, he's actually lost some time. Oh, here we go.
Whoa!
Robin Friscott ran a little wide there, and then Monster Energy and yes, Monster Energy Endurance just kind of lost it there. Hit the side of the NX Racing Blue car.
Yeah, oh, twice actually. So I wonder if there's a bit of damage on the NX Racing Blue car.
Most likely is damage, but Robin's just going to ignore it, I would assume. Here we go for another. Probably messy corner.
That's going to be really difficult. How many endurances on the outside in that light blue car? Oh, collects them through nicely. And there's another car ahead.
For High Revs Racing.
So, yeah, we thought the battle was over, but in fact, Iberica back ahead again into that fourth position. This is a great battle.
And they did not get the greatest of run out of La Source here. So if Robin Friscott can get another good run through Eau Rouge, we might see the same thing that we saw happen a couple laps ago.
Yeah, it wasn't great.
He does get a good run.
Yeah, it wasn't great for Iberica. Very good for Friscott, though. To the outside. Brake a little later. Can he get the inside for the second element of corner? And he's done so. It's exactly the same as last time. Great move.
Yeah, I think Robin's used to the F1 car. He's used to actually having to make that move quite often sometimes because of, you know, the defending and whatnot that happens there. So yeah, I think he feels a little comfortable, knows where he has to run. And a lot of trust also with the Iberica Racing team, making sure they don't run wide.
Just wondering whether that NX Racing blue car has any after that contact with the Monster Energy car last lap.
If it does, it's very light and it seems to not be affecting him too much. Don't worry, just a quick look back for a few seconds. Anders Dahl is just behind Ben Testing. Pretty much the exact same situation as you see in, with Iberica Racing Team and NX Racing.
Yeah, the Virgil doesn't have the straight line speed, and so it's really struggling to have a go down the straight, which would be the primary overtaking spot. The Iberica car coming back, having a go into La Source, but no opportunity. Is this not over?
A little mistake there by Robin Friskops, but as you can see, if Iberica Racing can get a good run through Eau Rouge, highly possible. That doesn't look like it, actually. It looks like they lost a little bit of time.
Yeah, they've not had very good runs through that Eau Rouge the last few laps. It's nice that we've got a couple of good battles going on in the last 15 minutes of this race. Keeps us entertained. You even sound kind of awake, Phil, which is good.
Yes, I'm actually wide awake right now. Anders Dahl just dropped back to a second behind Ben Testing, just a heads up. It looked like he was close, and then something happened, maybe a small mistake once he got close to him.
Yeah, it was a 0.284 gap at the previous sector, so something's gone awry there.
See both these two teams on screen, NX Racing Blue and Iberica Racing Team, just absolutely pushing the cars to the limit.
Like Friskops is managing the gap now. I think the lack of straight line from the roof is causing issues for Iberica. I think they might have to wait for another set of lapped cars, but I can't see any coming soon. In fact, I'd be surprised if they reach the car before the end of the race.
It's actually quite strange you say about the straight line speed. The BMW actually should be the weakest in the straight line. However, I believe NX Racing's had a pretty low wing here.
Yeah, so it must be the only explanation. Yeah, it's pretty major.
Remember we were talking about the cars not having drivers in them?
Yeah.
See? Look inside the car.
They're not there.
They are not there.
Oh my god. Ghost cars.
Yeah, this is an interesting situation.
Is now a suitable time to play the Knight Rider theme?
Yeah, I just noticed it because I saw it flash, and when I saw it flash, I saw the driver name also flash. So this
yes.
is a very interesting situation.
I'm confused.
Yes.
As per usual, then.
This car on the right slowing down. Who was GT Ross Orange? Wow, what? Are they still in this race?
Yes, they are trying to nurse their way around and possibly get the 36th position.
They're not going to complete enough laps, though. Surely.
No, no.
They're only on
three
they're
laps.
On, they're on 236. Oh, no, 359 laps. No, sorry, they're on 236 laps completed.
Oh, sorry, I'm looking at number 114. You're looking at number 112, which, yes,
yeah.
They should not be on the racetrack.
That's very strange. Yeah, there's no way they can score points like that, even if they do finish, because they're not going to be classified.
you guys, but I'm holding my breath a little bit.
Yeah, this battle's still not settled yet. I think the Virgil one, the Virgil versus Camaro one, probably is. I think Ben Tusting has the pace now. But yes, this NX Racing Blue.
Yeah, I think that Anders Dahl and the Virgil Racing car just had to push a bit too much. And then once they're in the draft, it's just been really tough for them to make a move, simply because they don't have that straight line speed, and the straight line speed is what you need to make a move.
Cecilia looking pretty racy going into La Source. He had a little look just to let Friskopf know there's no chance of a pass, but I do wonder whether they might have a last lap, an ambitious last lap pass.
Getting a lot closer this time around.
Looks like Cecilia has a little bit, I think he has a bit more traction in these track, which makes me think, but the problem is it's so difficult to pass that you can't really take advantage unless the driver in front makes a mistake.
Yeah, this is incredible.
Yeah, we always, MLE has a tradition of always having a great last lap battle. It might not always for the lead, although it often is, but there's always something going on the last lap, and this time it's the battle for P4. And that will have a impact on championship standings as well, because of the amount of points available. And so, yeah, going up one position will get you a good haul of points. So, if you're joining us, well, if we're under 10 minutes to go now in this 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing, we're currently watching the battle for P4. Between NX Racing Blue and Iberica Racing Team. Up at the front of the field, it's NX Racing Red leading with Jake Sturgios behind the wheel. That looks to be pretty much, well, barring any problems, they should have that. Martin Conker in second position for the Quanda Simsport team. And third is Core Motorsports, Danny Gusa, who's two of the leaders, and a minute ahead of this battle that you're watching on screen right now. Twenty-three hours and 52 minutes.
Once again, NX Racing Blue gets a good run through a Rouge.
Yeah. That really just, I mean, that's the place where most overtaking has been going on, and to have a disadvantage down the straight is very frustrating.
And I think, yeah, this is definitely another place that they need to watch out for.
Yeah. I think potential, if there's a minor mistake from Friskopf, there is definitely potential, but he's been driving pretty much wheel perfect these last few laps, so I can't really see an opportunity.
Yeah, the roof is just really, really strong. Lacombe really gets the rotation in and can really power off going down to turn 8. Just want to note that Anders Dahl and Virgil Racing dropped to about a second and a half to 1.8 seconds back of Ben Tusting, Team Camaro car. So this is pretty much the main battle that's going on in the race right now. Good time to have a battle. 7 minutes to go. Current leader is NX Racing Red, Jake Sturgis behind the wheel. Going to Simsport in second, Martin Kronk behind the wheel. We have Core Motorsports in third, and then this battle for fourth and fifth.
Yeah, it looks like we're going to get 601 or two laps from the leaders. Not bad going.
Well, I can tell you right now, 602 laps, 60% is 361 laps. Scott Michaels is well over that.
Are we going to get a... Oof, I thought you might give it a dive bomb there at La Source.
He keeps looking, keeps looking. I mean, he might do it at the end, not sure. A good way to end this race. See a lapped car up ahead, however, I believe that Pure Racing Team 3 will move out of the way.
Yeah, they'll have to move out of the way, they just won't catch them, because it's not long. Two or three laps. So it looks like 603 laps are going to be is the final total.
But it'll be starting the 603rd lap, but I think it's actually going to be 602 completed.
Oh.
I may be wrong.
It's about as, this is about as close as Cecilia has been for the last couple of laps. Now, could this Pure Racing car?
Watch out here.
Yeah, I think this the Pure Racing car should get out of the way because they've been pretty, they've been very good this race. Pure Racing car's in 18th position with Mert Uzel behind the wheel.
I see Birka Racing team kind of just dropping back right now, seeing if they can somehow make a run. Oh, and here we go. Robert Christoph's running a little wide there.
Yeah, this could be a really good opportunity for a pass into La Source now. Yeah, that's Luke using a bit of off-track there to gain an advantage. But I... Oh, is he going to... No. He's got a couple more opportunities. Up to Eau Rouge, the place where this roof is not strong. Because of the worn tyres.
There's a lot of curve there. It helped him a little bit, but he still dropped off. You can see that in the live gap.
Under 4 minutes now.
If anyone wants to know, these two drivers are two of the fastest drivers on track. So they are not slowing each other down at all by battling right now. Only car that is faster is Martin Kronk, and that is by less than 1/10 of a second.
There's another battle going further down the field, but we're going to stay with this. Infinity Esports is looking to pass All-Star Racing Team for P19. It's car 46 and 1/26 battling. But this right now, this battle for fourth is the most significant in terms of position. Again, nice and late on the brakes, able to brake later and almost trail brake into the corner is Cecilia, and still come out quicker. Must be quite frustrating because he feels like this part of the track is where he's much quicker, but there's just no way through. The corners aren't tight enough and there's not enough braking to allow a speed differential to facilitate a pass.
Oh, he's really close here.
Ooh, this could be into second part of Longchamp. He had to put his foot on the brake. Which he caught him at the wrong moment. And he can't get this distance into bus stop. I guess he used the brake instead of lifting off just to stabilise the car. Because lifting off there is a little bit dangerous.
See him running a very wide entry into the final corner. So he can get a really fast exit. Seems to work, but it's not enough here.
To lap, we're now on lap 600. Oof, big slide, that'll have worn the tyres.
Yeah, lots of tyre spin there.
Didn't really lose that much time, though. That roof is very, very quick off the corners. So a little bit of tire spin didn't hurt too much.
That was a better run through Eau Rouge for Iberica there, because they actually used the brakes on the way in, which gave them a good exit. But it's still not going to be enough.
I believe Jakester just passed the line to start his final lap. So these cars still have to cross the line one more time before they start their final lap.
So he's got one more opportunity into La Source and one more opportunity into Les Coombes. We will cut to next race in red when the time is right, so we can see them across the line.
Yeah, and what's terrible is they will be going down the Kemmel Straight when that happens. So, gonna try to cut that real fast for the viewers, make sure they don't miss anything. So if anyone wants to take any pictures of the finish cars passing the finish line, please do that quickly.
To Stavolo, these two. I think I might be sensing enough. I think the Sicilia will time it slightly better. Oh, that's a car off in front of them. Who's that? That was Vortex.
Yeah.
Incident pattern rate for them. Now, how is he going to catch him into Blanchimon this time? He's going to go for the... No, he had to put the foot on the brake and lost loads of time again. So frustrating.
Oh, he kept a little bit closer, but this isn't enough to make a move.
Nope. Last time into La Source for these guys. And out of the chicane comes Inex Racing at the wheel. Crosses the finishing line to win the Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps. Fantastic win for Inex Racing Red. A full minute and 15 seconds ahead of second place, who have yet to cross the line, and they're on their way there at the moment. We're back watching this battle for fourth, but it looks like Iberica
didn't get the best run there.
That's resolved. So Jake Sturgios is actually still continuing at full speed. Commander SimSport will be coming through in second in a few moments. They're currently making their way through Blanchimon. Meanwhile, we continue to watch this battle for fourth. Friscops has it at the moment for Inex Racing Blue. His teammates have just come through to win the race. Commander SimSport's now coming into the bus stop chicane. Martin Krunker at the wheel. And Commander, who had such a piece of bad luck at the beginning of the race yesterday, a brilliant recovery drive. Commander SimSport comes second in the 24 Hours of Spa. The next car we expect to cross the line, or may have already crossed the line, in fact, is Core Motorsports, two laps down. Yeah, they're already finished. They're doing donuts.
Both drivers use a lot of this outside of the circuit there.
So now I'm going to go back to this battle, yeah. We come into the bus stop chicane for the final time. It looks like Inex Racing Blue have secured their fourth position. Very, very close. But Iberica not able to take fourth, but it's still a great race for those two. Really thrilling end.
This is after the race. They've already finished. I was going to say, actually, are the overlay saying Anders Dahl got sixth position, but is that correct?
It would look, according to the tracker, yeah.
And by any chance, is the server crashing right now? Oh, that must have been just me timing out there.
So there we go. That is your official top 10 positions for the Spa 24 Hours, supported by Blue Flag Racing. InX Racing Red takes victory. Coanda SimSport, a brilliant second. Core Motorsports in third. InX Racing Blue just held on to fourth at the finish. Iberica Racing Team, a fine fifth. Team Camara 2, classified as sixth now. Seventh is Virgil Racing. Eighth, Radicals Online 2. Ninth, Mad Cow Racing 2. And 10th, Pure Racing Team 1. Brilliant race. Really, really quality stuff all the way through. We'll be having words with the winning teams shortly. So you can see there, NX Racing Red parked at the start line, where there'll be an official photo for the top three cars. And that gives NX Racing Red the lead of the championship as well. Core Motorsports will be second, and Coanda SimSport will be third. And this is a race that I think will prove to be a major turning point in the championship. Now with only two races to go, they're both single point, like normal points races. So we have pretty much four very strong challenges for the championship, with InX Racing Red leading them there. The next round, of course, will be the 6 hours of the Circuit of the Americas, sponsored by GrandPrix247.com. So we'll momentarily have drivers from coming to have a chat about their race. The final winning margin was just over a minute. So outside of the top 10, Vortex Sim Racing were 11th, R4R 12th, 13th Team TTL, who had a very action-packed race, Phoenix Motorsport were 14th, Kraut Racing 15th, AB Racing Black and AB Racing Silver 16th and 17th, Pure Racing number 3 were 18th, 19th, Infinity Esports, and 20th, All-Star Racing Team number 3.
Trying to actually get a hold. Here we go.
So joining us in the commentary booth, driver Jake Sturgis. Jake, congratulations on the win. That was one hell of a race.
Yeah, thanks. I really didn't expect this going into the race. I knew we had a good team, a good lineup, a good setup, a good strategy. And it just all came together, mostly our competition getting wrecked by lap cars. So that was unfortunate for them. Would have been a lot more exciting had that not happened to Coanda on Redline. We would have had to push a lot harder, I think, especially at the end. But would have made for a better race. It was still great. I'm still really happy that we won. It's unreal. Like, the whole team was just screaming in team speak, and especially with the blue car getting fourth place, that was great too. But yeah, can I get off the track? I'm still sitting on the start finish line with the slowdown penalty that I've had for 5 minutes now.
No, we like to just look at you sitting at the finish line.
You like to wave the black flag at me too. It's still
lingering. I can't see that. I can see that.
No, it's. It was when the server lagged out there on the end lap.
Okay, so you guys had that too? Okay, good.
Yeah,
I was going to say, is the server really crashing there on the end lap?
Yeah.
Good time for it. So that race gives you the lead of the championship. Are you now possibly thinking about the championship win, or are you just taking it each race at a time?
Well, the championship's always in mind, and we knew this was the most important race. We needed a top five for sure, and to win it probably puts us ahead of in the championship by quite a bit. We don't know how much, but with COTA coming up next, that's one of the BMW's worst tracks, so we'll see how that goes. We basically need to finish top 10 there. And then Bathurst, who knows what can happen there. That's always crazy. But yeah, we'd really love to win the championship, of course. Now we're in a really good position to do it. So we'll see how the rest of the season goes.
Brilliant. Well, congratulations, Jake, on that win to the whole of the NX team as well for the first and fourth position in that race. Brilliant stuff.
Thanks, guys.
Second place in that race was Commander Simsport, and joining us in the box is Jorn Jens, who was part of that team, drove quite a few stints in that race. Jorn, how are you feeling after that 24-hour race? It was a tough one, especially after the incident at the beginning yesterday.
Yes, we are very happy with the result, as it still gives us all chances for the championship. The incident was quite unlucky, as we had no chance to get around it, and the rest of the race was just getting back into the pit schedule, so we would not have to make an extra stop. So that's basically what put us one minute down to Einix, and well, no chance to get that back with their pace. Really good.
And you guys, the only other team on the lead lap as well, so it would have been interesting had the incident not happened where you would have ended up. But nonetheless, really important result for the championship. I think that puts you now into third in the championship. So again, probably a good chance to have a go at the championship this time around. Is that something you'll be looking to do, or are you just taking each race as it comes?
Well, of course, each race is important to score very good results, win if possible.
Well, congratulations on the second position anyway. Really, really superb race to recover to second.
Thank you.
And third position, Core Motorsports in their roof. And joining us in the box is Danny Gusa. You were doing donuts at the end there, so I'm assuming you're pretty happy with that podium finish.
Yeah, actually, we're very happy because when you see all those names which we are racing against and we are finished third, we don't have the speed at all, but we try to get everything out of consistency and get everything away from us, crashes or something like that. And our strategy worked fine, and I have no words for that, what how I feel and my teammates are feeling. So yeah.
Towards the end of the race, you were pretty secure in third to the end of the race, but I guess, there's lots of things that could still go wrong. There could be back markers, there could be iRacing bugs. Were you quite nervous in that last stint?
Actually, I was quite nervous, and my teammates too. We checked always our internet connection and just do a reconnect, so we have no 24-hour disconnects or something like that, and restart the PC. But actually, you can't do anything against Murphy's Law, so for us it was like when we get third place we're fine, but when there's something a higher force that will prevent it, so we have to accept it.
Indeed. All right, well, Danny, congratulations on your third position. Wonderful racing from you guys as well, so congratulations.
Yeah, thank you, and congratulations to Inex and Kuenda. Great race. If we hadn't any problems, I guess we never would match their speed. This was crazy how fast they were from the first stint to the last, and from beginning to the end of the stint. This was crazy. Congratulations.
Brilliant stuff. Thanks, Danny. So that pretty much wraps up this Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps. We've got lots of thanks to give, of course, first of all to Blue Flag Racing at facebook.com/Blue Flag Racing, who were the supporters of this event, providing the prize money, £75, £50 and £25 to the top three positions. IGPManager.com for their support as well. Derek Spear Designs at derekspeardesigns.com, also supporting this series. And GrandPrix247.com as well. Thank you for your support. There are lots of people, of course, to thank as well. The race admins, Jonathan Palmer, Michael Booth, and Phil Diaz. And Phil Diaz also commentated and controlled cameras as well, so did an awful lot for this event. So thank you very much Phil. Also in the commentary box, we had, again, Jonathan Palmer, Phil Diaz, Lewis McGlade, Oscar Hardwick, and myself, Michael Passingham. So I hope you enjoyed hearing our voices for the last 24 as well. So that pretty much wraps it up. So we'll see you next time for the 6 hours of the Circuit of the Americas. It's penciled in for the 31st of January, but it may get moved back. Obviously, keep an eye on Facebook and Twitter to find out exactly what the date of that race will be. So until then, goodbye.